Hi everyone, welcome back to the workshop. It's a rather cold Saturday here today, so I thought I'd spend a little bit of time in the workshop just generally tidying things up, and I've actually gone ahead and extended the depth of my main workbench, as you can see here. I've just extended it by, you know, 6 or 7 inches or so, just to give me that little bit of extra depth for when you're working in some large equipment or some deep equipment, that sort of thing. It was always really temporary. The original depth was, you know, roughly 650 mm, but I've managed to extend it quite a bit, so I'm up at 850 now, so it's quite ideal now for doing much bigger jobs on the actual bench and having plenty of room round about me for the iron and my tools and all that sort of thing. So just I'll zoom out there and let you see the status of the workbench at the moment. As you can see, kind of fit for purpose for what I want to do in the workshop. So anyway, I've got a project that I want to sort of get on with today. Hopefully it'll just be a quick video, because there's not much to this particular mod that I want to make on this device. So let's go and have a look. Okay, so what I've actually got here is my Philip Harris mains AC current and power meter here. I use this in the workshop for basically measuring the power consumption of any devices, you know, 240 volt devices that I want to plug in here. And you've got a simple little readout here that's basically switchable between the current or the power in kilowatts there. Now what I want to actually do with this device, you know, although it works great and the switch works great and all the rest of it, I want to actually modify it a bit just to simplify things a little. I want to get rid of this switch and I want to put two displays on here instead of the one that's switchable, a single switchable one. So what that'll involve is going inside the unit, having a look at see how the current one is configured, the configuration of the switch and how it's switching the signals to the LCD, and see what I can do there. It's a cheap and cheerful unit, this unit, so it's just going to be a DVM. There's not going to be any microprocessors or anything like that inside here, so it's just going to be, you know, a simple DVM there. It's either going to be 200 millivolts or 2 volts full scale, that sort of off-the-shelf DVMs there. And I suspect that this switch here is basically just selecting a voltage before it goes to the actual DVM there. You know, it'll be pre-scaled voltage in terms of the power in kilowatts or the current in amps here. So what I will have to do, of course, is cut a larger hole there to mount the two DVMs onto. So I'm Scottish, of course, so that means not spending a lot of money. So I've got a bunch of DVMs, etc., in my parts bins there. So some bits and pieces I've saved up over the years. So having a look in here, I think I've actually got a couple of little units here that should do the job rather nicely. These are just bought off of eBay quite a long time ago. They're CX101Bs. I don't really know the manufacturer, they're just made in China, as you can see there. So hopefully they'll do the job. So if we just take a look at one of them inside here, so you've got the instructions there, I'll put that aside at the moment. And here it is. It's quite a nice little slim line panel meter. There's not a lot of bezel round about it, which I think is going to be ideal for what I want to do. And then you've got a header on the back, which basically gives you all your configuration for things like decimal point positions and scale select, and then your reference inputs, etc. And comparing that to the size of the original Philip Harris ones, if I can just offer it up, you can see that it's not too bad a difference in size. It's almost the same width, so I think there should be quite a lot of scope for me putting them both side by side there, or one above the other. What I'll actually do with the switch, I don't think I'll even need to cut down as far as the switch. You know, there could have been an opportunity here to actually wipe out the switch for mounting that one there, but I quite like the idea of having them really close together with the two bezels as close together. Now, I'm not going to retain the original DVM. I'm actually going to get rid of it, because, you know, I do actually have a number of these CX101Bs in here, so I'm actually going to put two new devices in there and replace the existing one. So what that'll involve is opening up the Philip Harris meter and just doing a bit of documentation on exactly how the existing one's driven, also in reference to the switch, measure some voltages, see if I can get some sort of idea as to the voltage scale driving the DVM in reference to the, you know, AC current or kilowatts there, and the power from whatever I'm plugging in. So we'll do that first and get some sort of idea as to how that'll work. There are issues with these things. If you've never used DVMs like these before, there can be issues with them. Some of them have differential voltage inputs. Some of them have a low input, which is referenced to the power supply negative. Some of the ones that have differential inputs don't like the input low tied to the power supply low. They just don't work. So there can be a few things to catch you out there. So I want to make sure that I can actually run this in place of the original one there, and then on top of that I want to make sure I can actually run two of these reference to the same signal negative. I think it should be okay, but it's always worth a test. And just one little word here before I actually open it up. This is a mains operated device. It's got low voltage DC and it's also obviously got mains AC in it. If you're going to be following this and maybe making your own modification to something similar or the same unit, be very, very careful. This is mains AC powered. So first things first, let's open it up. So as you can see, you've got the two side covers off, plastic side covers, and you can see the top and bottom of the case are split, so I should be able to remove this bottom cover there to give me full access onto the main board in there. As there, you can see the main board there, and you can see the DVM. Don't know, the light's not that great in here, but you can see the DVM there and all the connections on it on a header inside there coming up onto the main board. So we'll get the cover off and we'll take a look. And there we go. Nicely split. So you can see the main board there with all the components, and then we've got the interface onto the 240 volts AC there, and then we've got a bunch of connections onto the actual back of this DVM there. And looking at it, we've got one, two, three, four, five wires, so that's pretty good, that's looking good. We've got a decimal point position there, DP2. So what I suspect that's doing is when we switch between kilowatts and amps there, it's going to be selecting a different decimal point based on the switch. So that's probably what that's for. Then you've got a bunch of wires here. They're all linked up together. That'll be just tying the reference low and the common etc. together, just part of the options available in driving these DVMs. So that's what we've got there. It looks like they go under the wires, go under the board, but they don't. They're just looped round there onto the various pins there. And then the next wire coming up onto the board is VSS. That'll be your power supply 0 volts there. The next one is this grey wire, that's in low, so that'll be the signal input low side. And then you've got in high, which is the input signal high side. So this is your differential voltage here by the looks of it. It does look like in low is not tied to VSS. As I mentioned earlier, it's quite normal for that to be the case. So it's a differential input there. And then you've got VDD, which is your supply over at this side here. So I do actually want to power it up and measure at least what a couple of things. I want to measure what the actual supply voltage is. It could be 5 volts, it could be anything else, it could be an unregulated voltage. So I don't really know much about this particular DVM, whether it's got a built-in regulator or not, or whether it actually needs 5 volts. So we'll take a look at that, and we'll also measure the differential voltage across here based on the positions of the switch there. And if you do look, there's a switch there, and if you do look inside, just basically the switch is mounted directly onto the PCB, so I'll probably have to remove the PCB as well if I have to. And then you can see the three connections for the switch on the back of the PCB there. Okay, before I actually go and power it up, I have put some masking tape over the back of some of the live terminals, uncovered terminals, uninsulated wiring, etc. on the back of the unit here, just as a little bit of a safety precaution. It's hardly British standards or anything like that, safety at work and all the rest of it. But, you know, like I said, be careful if you're doing something like this at home. Okay, it's actually powered up now, though you can't see any light or anything on this side, so I'm being very careful here. So this black wire is VSS, so we'll get on there, and this red wire at the end here is VDD, so that's the power supply to the actual DVM, so we're 10.2 volts DC, so that's fine, and I've got no load connected at all, so we'll just go across the in low and the in high, which is this two here. And I've got 0 volts there. I'll just switch to the millivolts position there. And we've got 0 millivolts. That's correct. Nothing plugged in. Okay, so I'm going to plug in a load now just to see what sort of signal I'm getting on that differential voltage there. So I'm actually going to just quickly plug in my workshop wall-mounted heater. And it's a 400-watt device, a 400-watt heater. So we'll just see what happens with it. Okay, and there's the heater up and running. So you're looking at about 440 watts there. That's about right for the heater. And I'll just switch it over to the current. We've got 1.92 amps. So the first thing I'm going to actually do is document that. I'm going to write that down so that when I get the new DVMs up and running, I've got some sort of ballpark references to go by. I've turned it over so that I've got access to the differential voltage in the back there. So I'm actually going to probe it. So I'm running at 1.91 amps now. So we're going to go across the in high and the in low. So that's there and there. And I'll just switch the millivolts. 19.1 millivolts. So I'll just write that down. 19.1 millivolts. And we'll switch over to the kilowatt position there and measure again. 4.3 millivolts. Okay, let's do some calculations here just to see what we've got. So I'd measured 1.91 amps drawn from via the heater, and that was giving me 19.1 millivolts on the DVM, and also 0.44 kilowatts was 4.3 millivolts there. Now if I build up an equation here, basically the DVM is a 3.5-digit device, so its maximum is going to be 1999, and assuming it's a 200 millivolt input DVM for full scale, that's 1999 is going to give me 200 millivolts there. If I cross multiply with my measured 19.1 millivolts, that's going to give me a display value of 0191, and of course that's the 4 digits on the DVM, so the decimal point was in the second position there, so that's there, so that's there's your 1.91 amps, so it's definitely a 200 millivolt scale DVM. And also similarly for the kilowatt position, same calculation but with the 4.3 millivolts measured, that gives me 0429, and with a decimal point in this position here, that's going to give me 0.429 kilowatts, which is not far off of the 0.44 kilowatts that I'd actually measured. Okay, what I decided to do was do a small schematic diagram of the unit just so I could work out exactly how the differential voltage drive in the DVM was working. So, disconnected 4 screws there, and also the neutral wire from the 13 amp socket. That leaves me quite flexible for moving it around. I also had to remove 4 screws that were holding the DVM in place. No desoldering required, so that was quite good. So I've actually gone ahead and done a little partial schematic for the unit just so we can see how it's actually interfacing with the DVM. Okay, and here's the schematic diagram that I've produced for the DVM drive. It's not totally correct. There's probably some other tie-ins to various other places on the board, but I've got enough documented here that I think I can go forward in working out how to interface to the two separate DVMs. So basically you've got a single IC on the board here, an LM358. It's got a low voltage AC signal coming into it, and then that's AC coupled on C6. You've got a couple of small rectifier diodes there, therefore producing voltage across C8. That's proportional, obviously, to the current and wattage, being measured by the device. So you've basically got a voltage divider here. R10 is the feed coming from the op-amp effectively. So that goes through R10, and basically you've got that going off to in high on the DVM. The other half of the voltage divider is then coming down here, and it's basically selecting either of two resistors onto the low side. So basically there's your voltage divider, R10 and R12, or R10 and R11 there. And if you look at the values of R11 and R12, you're 615 ohm and 2.7k. That's actually, let me just grab another bit of paper here. That's actually the same ratio of the difference between this 4.3 millivolts and the 19.1 millivolts. So that's where that's coming from. So basically what I'll do is I'll replicate both the voltage dividers separately so that I'm producing them two separate voltages driving in high there, both running at the same time. Whether I actually retain R9 in the trim pot, not too sure, we'll see how that goes. So the next thing I'm going to do, before I actually start desoldering any of the existing wiring, etc., I'm going to take a look at the mounting arrangement of the two DVMs here and just see exactly how I'm going to do this. So if I just lift up that there, if I can just put this back in there, so there's it all sort of laid down exactly as it was before. You can see that there's quite a bit of head height here between the PCB and the front panel, but probably not quite enough for my new DVM. If you can just see that there, it's quite a bit deeper, this one, than the original one. It's not a problem in itself, it's just probably going to be more of a problem depending on where I put these two DVMs, but just by luck there's quite a big hole here that they've cut out to get access to the original DVM. There's probably actually enough room for me to put the two of them side by side there, right close together, and in actual fact it just it's almost like it was made for it there. So I think I'll probably get away with that. The other option would be, if there wasn't enough room here, I could have actually lifted the board upwards slightly, put some bigger standoffs there, and maybe raised it up a 20 mil or something like that to give me a lot more headroom here. But you know, I don't think I'm going to have to do that. I think I'll get away with just sort of mounting them there, and maybe I'll put a bit of Vero board with a couple of single inline headers on the back of the board there, because I will actually have to fit a 5 volt regulator. I think these are 5 volt devices. I'll have to check the data sheet. I think they're 5 volt devices, so I will actually have to put a 5 volt regulator in here, tapping on to that 10 volts, I think it was, supply there. So I'll do that on a bit of Vero board actually, and they'll mount on the board that goes in the back of there. And then from there I can just link some wires directly from there onto the main board there, and all my resistors, etc., can go on the Vero board. Okay, there's the DVMs mounted, the new ones. Looks not too bad on the front. And if I just flip it over here, you can see what I've more or less done in the back. Yes, I've managed to retain the circuit board, the Vero board that I've put on the top within the existing hole in the PCB, so it all just goes in rather nicely. I've just hot glued the DVMs in place for this now, and I've used a couple of Arduino type headers on the pins in the back of the DVM so that I can easily just remove the board, no problem. So I'll have to do that anyway to get to all my resistors and all the rest of it that I need to put on the other 5 volt regulator. So I'll away and start working on that now, and we'll see how we get on. Okay, that's it all wired up here, as you can see, and it's all working as well. Both DVMs are working, recording the amps and the power. One problem I did come across was the instructions. They're in Chinglish, so it's a little bit hard to understand exactly what's going on in terms of the wiring up of the DVMs. There's actually three different kinds available: a CX101A, a B, and a BG, and the kind of given three different diagrams for each. But that's not the only way to hook them up. You do have to pay attention as to whether you're actually commoning up the supply negative to the signal negative. Now I'm not doing that, so I'm kind of going by this diagram here, which is actually for the CX101B, as it says there. But hooking it up in this particular configuration, it wasn't working too well. So I've actually changed things slightly. I've actually hooked it up in as per this wiring here, but without connecting the V minus to the in low. I've left that open, so basically I do have the common pin 5 tied to rail on pin 8. Then I've basically just got the in low going straight out and the in high going straight out there, and that's hooking up to the existing circuit there, and that seems to be working good. So if I go back to the unit here, I'll just turn it over and put power on and we'll see what we're getting. Okay, I'll just switch it on now. Obviously I've got no load connected, so I should be getting zero on the display. So I think this one's the power and this one's the amps. No, sorry, the other way around. This one's the amps and this one's the power. So as you can see there, with nothing connected, zero. So I'll just plug in my heater. And we should be getting the figures I'd recorded before. There we go. 1.92 amps and 0.43 kilowatt, which is more or less the figures I was getting before, 1.91 amps and 0.44 kilowatts. So that's roughly just about correct there. So back on the other side again, one thing I did have to do, I didn't want to spend all day choosing the correct resistors on the voltage divider. So I just, you know, basically put in some nominal values, because the actual DVMs themselves do have a span pot in the back there, and it's actually quite a coarse adjustment. It's not like you just have a you know, a tiny little variance in the display. It does swing, you know, from one end almost to the other, so it's actually quite hard to get it spot on because it's so sensitive, which I wasn't expecting. So I did actually use that with my nominal values on the voltage dividers there. I did actually use them to calibrate the display to get my 1.9 amps and my 0.44 kilowatts there. So I think the next thing to do is label it up. Okay, it's all labelled up and all put back together again, so another useful tool for the workshop. Thanks for watching.